Welcome students. In previous lecture you have learned about the cardiac cycle. Now in this lecture I am going to explain about the cardiac output. Now as you have learned in the previous lectures, cardiac output is the ultimate product of the end of the cardiac cycle at the end of 1 minute. Now cardiac output, it gives information about the function of the heart. Heart pumps blood in the circulation and it provides constant supply of oxygen as well as the nutrients to the various cells in the body. So it is essential for the heart to pump blood in our body. Now it is a routine procedure to assess the cardiac output to understand the function of the heart in the patient in our clinics as well as in the ICU setup. So cardiac output, it gives information about the cardiac health and its function. In this lecture, I will explain about general definitions related to this topic. Then I will explain about the measurement of the cardiac output. This will be a brief information about the measurement of the cardiac output for the experimental purpose as well as the measurement in our clinics. Then it is essential to understand about the variation in cardiac output in the physiological as well as in the pathological condition. Both this topic, measurement of the cardiac output as well as the variation in the cardiac output, this topic, they are important for the viva purpose as well as in your practicals. Then I will explain about the factors affecting cardiac output and regulation of the cardiac output in our body. So in this lecture, I will explain about the measurement of the cardiac output as well as the variation in the cardiac output, and all the remaining topics, they will be covered in the other lectures. So let's begin. Okay, now first of all, understand about some general definitions and the concept of the cardiac output. First of all, the stroke volume. As you have learned in the previous lecture, stroke volume is the amount of the blood that is ejected by the each ventricle at the end of the cardiac cycle or per beat. Now, the cardiac output, it refers to the amount of the blood which is ejected by each ventricle per minute. So stroke volume is the amount of the blood which is ejected at the end of each beat. But when we measure this stroke volume in the terms of 1 minute, then it gives information about the cardiac output. So cardiac output is equal to stroke volume multiplied with the heart rate in 1 minute. So cardiac output is equal to stroke volume. Stroke volume is usually 70 ml. And heart rates, if we considered mean heart rate as the 80, then it gives information about the cardiac output as on an average 5.6 liter per minute. The range is 5 to 6 liter per minute. Now the stroke volume. Stroke volume is the 70 ml. Now if you remember from the previous lectures, end diastolic volume, it is the volume which is remaining inside the ventricle at the end of the diastole. And end systolic volume is the volume of the blood which is remaining in the ventricle at the end of the systole. So stroke volume is equal to end diastolic volume minus end systolic volume. Now normally end diastolic volume is 130 ml and end systolic volume, it is about 50 ml. So stroke volume is about 70 to 80 ml. Now the cardiac index. So when we express cardiac output in relation to the body surface area, it gives information about the cardiac index. So in short, or in the simple terms, cardiac index is the cardiac output in expression of the body surface area. And the normal value of the cardiac index is about 3.2 liter per minute per meter square. So these are the general definition, and you must remember all this definition because they are helpful in your study as well as in your exams. Ejection fraction. Ejection fraction, as the word suggests, it is the fraction which is ejected from each ventricle at the end of one beat. So it is the percentage of the end diastolic ventricular volume that is ejected by each stroke. So ejection fraction is equal to stroke volume divided by end diastolic volume. So in simple means, it is the stroke volume or the volume of the blood that is ejected from the end diastolic volume. So normal ejection fraction is around 50 to 65%. So 50 to 65% of the blood is ejected from the end diastolic volume as the stroke volume in the normal persons. But whenever cardiac function declines, then normal ejection fraction also decreases. So we can say that the ejection fraction is a valuable index for ventricular pump function, and whenever ejection fraction decreases, we can say that ventricular pump function is declined or it is abnormal. So it is a valuable index to assess the ventricular pump function. Now the cardiac output, it varies in our daily activities. It also changes during the resting condition as well as during the exercise, during the physiological condition as well as during the pathological condition. So the maximum percentage of the cardiac output that can increase above the normal is called the cardiac reserve. So normally our cardiac output is within the range of the 5 to 6 liter in the non-athletes person. In the athletes, cardiac output is more because of the increase in the stroke volume and decrease in the heart rate. Now in the healthy adult, the maximum cardiac output that can be achieved is about 4 to 5 times of the normal cardiac output, that is about 50 to 20 liter per minute. So it is about 300 to 400%, and in athletically trained person, cardiac reserve is 500 to 600% or more, that is about 35 to 40 liter per minute, that is 7 to 8 times the normal cardiac output. So when the cardiac reserve of the person is more, then in the abnormal conditions or during the exercise, he can achieve the maximum level of the tissue perfusion because of the increased efficiency of the heart. So you must remember about all these definitions: stroke volume, cardiac output, end systolic volume, end diastolic volume, cardiac reserve, as well as the cardiac index and the ejection fraction. So now let's understand about the distribution of the cardiac output. So the cardiac output, it enters in the systemic circulation, and from the aorta it is distributed in the arteries, arterioles, and then capillaries, and it perfuses various body tissues. Now this distribution of the cardiac output is very important to understand, because in the liver, about 25% of the cardiac output it is provided, which is about 1500 ml per minute. So maximum cardiac output per minute, it goes to the liver. It is followed by kidney. So about 1260 ml per minute up to 1300 ml per minute, which is on an average about 25%, it also provided to the kidney. So about 50% of the cardiac output, it goes to the liver and kidney. Now in the brain, amount of the blood flow in ml per minute is about 750 ml per minute. In the heart, 250 ml per minute blood flow is provided, and in the lung, 500 ml per minute blood enters. So brain, heart and lung together, it constitutes about 1500 ml per minute, or 25% of the cardiac output it is provided. So all this together, 75% of the cardiac output, it is provided to the liver, kidney, brain, heart and lungs. So these are the vital organs, and 75% of the cardiac output, it goes to the vital organs. Always remember about the blood flow in ml per minute. These are the frequently asked question in your MCQ exam, in the pre-PG exam, and it is essential to understand that maximum blood flow, it goes to the liver, because liver, it is the important organ for the metabolism, so it requires more amount of the blood flow. In the kidney, more amount of the blood flow, it is required for the removal of the waste products as well as the conservation of the nutrients. In the brain, it is required for the constant amount of the oxygen supply. Heart, it is the central pump, so it requires regular constant blood flow. And in the lungs, for the oxygenation, constant blood flow is necessary. So always remember that 75% of the blood flow, it goes to the vital organs. In the skeletal muscles and other body organs, 1 liter per minute blood flow enters, and in the skin, blood flow is 500 ml per minute. So the 75% of the cardiac output, it is distributed to the vital organs. Okay, now I will explain about the measurement of the cardiac output, how cardiac output can be measured in the experimental animals as well as in our clinics. In experimental animals, usually the cardiac output, it can be measured by electromagnetic flow meter. Now in humans, only indirect methods, they are possible, and they include fixed principle or fixed method, indicator or dye dilution method, and thermodilution method, and various physical methods such as Doppler technique, echocardiography, and the Ballisto cardiography. You must remember all these methods for the measurement of the cardiac output. Now I will explain all these methods one by one. First, the electromagnetic flow meter. So here we can see the setup of this electromagnetic flow meter. This is the blood vessel, and these are the two magnets. So in this magnetic field, whenever blood passes through the vessel, it generates electrical potential. And this electrical potential difference, it can be measured by electrode placed on this blood vessel, and it is recorded by use of this voltmeter. So whenever blood flow, it passes through the vessel, electrical potential is generated with a change in the blood flow, which can be measured, and it shows amount of the blood which is passes through the blood vessel. So when we measure in the terms of 1 minute or at the end of 1 minute, it shows total amount of the cardiac output. Now in this figure we can see a modern electromagnetic flow meter. It can be placed around a great vessel, and it can record the potential difference or the current that is generated whenever blood passes through the great vessel, and we can record the cardiac output with the help of this electromagnetic flow meter. So in the experimental animals, electromagnetic flow meter, it is useful to record cardiac output. But because this is an invasive procedure, and it can produce hemorrhage, infection, so we usually prevent electromagnetic flow meter in the human subjects. So in the human subjects, we can record cardiac output with the use of various indirect method, which requires less invasive methods. Indirect methods that are helpful in the measurement of the cardiac output, they include fixed method, indicator, or the dye dilution method. First, understand about the fixed method. So first, fixed method, it depends on fixed principle, and it shows that the substance taken by the organ, it depends on arteriovenous difference of the substance multiplied with the blood flow. So this Q, it shows amount of the substance taken by the organ. A is the concentration of the substance at the arterial level. V shows concentration of the substance at the venous level. So arteriovenous difference multiplied with the F, that is the amount of blood flow. So the amount of the blood flow is equal to amount of the substance taken divided by arteriovenous difference, and this principle is known as Fick's principle. By using this Fick's principle, we can measure cardiac output by using all the data in the pulmonary circulation, because in the pulmonary circulation, amount of the substance that is taken constantly is oxygen, and the oxygen consumption is about 250 ml per minute, and we can measure arterial as well as the venous oxygen concentration. Arterial sample can be taken from any artery, and it shows concentration of the oxygen in the arterial level. In the venous level, we can measure the concentration of the oxygen in the pulmonary artery. For this purpose, catheter is introduced and it enters inside the right atria, right ventricle, and in the pulmonary artery. And from the pulmonary artery, oxygen concentration, it is measured. So in the pulmonary blood flow, so pulmonary blood flow is equal to cardiac output. Pulmonary blood flow is equal to amount of oxygen taken by the lungs per minute divided by arteriovenous difference of the concentration of oxygen. So cardiac output is equal to oxygen taken up by the lungs per minute divided by arteriovenous oxygen difference. So cardiac output is equal to oxygen consumption divided by arteriovenous oxygen difference. Oxygen consumption is 250 ml per minute. Arterial oxygen is 19 ml per deciliter and venous O2 is 14 ml per deciliter. So cardiac output is equal to 5 liter per minute. Now in this Fick's method, we must introduce cardiac catheter up to the pulmonary artery to measure the venous oxygen level. So this is an invasive technique, and whenever we use invasive technique, there are chances of hemorrhage as well as the infection. If by any error in the method, if we affect the ventricular walls, then the stimulation of the ventricular walls, it may result in the ventricular fibrillation as well as the rhythm abnormalities. So these are the various advantages of using Fick's principle for the measurement of cardiac output. Other indirect methods, they include indicator or the dye dilution method. Now in this method, a known amount of the dye, it is injected in the large vein, preferably in the right atrium by the cardiac catheterization. Then it will be evenly distributed in the bloodstream. Its mean concentration, it is determined from the successive samples of the blood taken from the artery. So the blood flow in the liter per minute, or F, is equal to Q. Q is the quantity of the dye injected divided by C, that is the mean concentration of the dye, and the T, it is the time taken in the second during the first passage through the artery. So by this method, we measure the mean concentration as well as the, by using the real value or the concentration of the dye injected in the circulation time, we can measure cardiac output. And because we measure cardiac output indirectly, this is the indirect method. Usually Evans blue is the dye injected for the measurement of the cardiac output. Thermodilution method, it is also helpful for the measurement of the cardiac output, and it works on the same principle as the indicator or the dye dilution method. In this method, a cold saline, it is injected directly in the ventricle, and then gradually change in the temperature, it is measured in the pulmonary artery. The cardiac output is measured from the values of the temperature by applying the principle of indicator dilution technique. Various physical methods, they are also useful for the measurement of the cardiac output. One of such methods that is widely used for the measurement of the cardiac output, that is echocardiography. So this echocardiography, it refers to the ultrasonic evaluation of the cardiac function, and it involves B-scan ultrasound at a frequency of 2.25 millihertz using a transducer. So whenever ultrasound waves, they are transmitted, and then the reflected ultrasound waves, it gives information about the function of the heart. Echocardiography, it gives information about the movement of the ventricular wall and septum and valves during the cardiac cycle. And whenever it is combined with the Doppler technique, echocardiography can be used to measure the velocity and volume of the flow through the valves. So the echocardiography is particularly useful in the evaluating end-diastolic volume, end-systolic volume, cardiac output, and valvular defects. Here in this picture, we can see all the chambers of the heart and the walls of the heart. This is left atria, left ventricle, right atria, and right ventricle. We can see the movement of various cardiac valves like tricuspid valve, and here we can see the mitral valve. So we can record the movement of the cardiac walls as well as the movement of the cardiac valves, and we can assess the pathology if it is present in the heart. Various other physical methods, they are also helpful in the measurement of the cardiac output, like ballistocardiography. In the ballistocardiography, the vibration generated by each heartbeat, they are received and recorded, and they are converted into the waveforms by the transducer. And these records of the cardiac activity with the help of various softwares, they are useful to assess the movement of the blood flow through the heart and the cardiac output. The pulse pressure method. Pulse pressure is the difference between the systolic and the diastolic pressure, and it provides a rough idea of the cardiac output whenever we measure the pulse. In the X-ray method, a radio opaque dye, it is injected intravenously, and then size of the heart, it is detected by the serial X-ray in the systole and diastole, from which cardiac output is measured. So from the echocardiography, ballistocardiography, pulse pressure method, and X-ray method, these are the various physical methods helpful in the record of the cardiac output. So now you have a good understanding about all the general definitions as well as various methods for the recording of the cardiac output. Now in our daily activities, cardiac output varies depending on the need of the tissues. So there are variations present in the cardiac output. So whenever under the normal situation, whenever cardiac output varies, these are the various physiological variation, and under various pathological condition, cardiac output also changes. These are the various pathological variations in cardiac output. First, understand about the physiological variation in cardiac output, or the cardiac output variation in the normal situations. First is the age. In the children, cardiac output is more because they have more body surface area than the adults. In the children, heart rate is also more. So in the children, heart rate is more than the adults. As the age increases, cardiac output decreases. In the old age, cardiac output is less because of the decline in the ventricular pumping function. So with increase in the age, cardiac output decreases. Sex is also an important factor. In the females, body surface area is less than the male. So in the female, cardiac output is less than the male. Diurnal variation or variation during the daytime, it is also present in the cardiac output. In the early morning, cardiac output is low and it increases in the daytime, probably because of the increase in the daily activities, diurnal variation is present. During the anxiety and the excitement state, cardiac output it increases and it can increase up to 50 to 100%. During the anxiety and as well as the excitement, autonomic nervous system, particularly sympathetic stimulation, is there and it increases cardiac output. After meals and eating, it is associated with the increase in the cardiac output up to 30%, because after meal metabolism increases, and because of the increase in the metabolism, cardiac output increases. Exercise is the period of the enhanced energy expenditure. So during the exercise, cardiac output increases to meet the oxygen as well as the nutrient demand of the tissue. So cardiac output increases up to 700% during the exercise, depending upon the vigorousness of the exercise. In the pregnancy, cardiac output increases up to 45 to 60%, and it increases because of the increase in the extracellular fluid volume. In the high altitude, cardiac output increases because of the sympathetic stimulation followed by hypoxia. So in the high altitude, cardiac output is more. With the change in the posture, cardiac output also changes because of the change in the venous return and the sympathetic stimulation. Sitting or standing from the lying down position may decrease the cardiac output by 20 to 30%. So from the sitting to standing position, cardiac output declines. But whenever we change our posture from the standing to supine posture, then the cardiac output increases because of the increase in the venous return. Prolonged standing posture can decrease the cardiac output and blood flow to the CNS. So in all the people who are exposed to prolonged standing posture, like the traffic police, they are more prone to develop syncope because of the decrease in the cardiac output. So physiological variation in the cardiac output, it includes variation in the age, sex, diurnal variation, variation during the exercise, excitement, as well as variation that occurs in the high altitude and change in the posture. These are all the variation during the normal condition or the physiological condition. Now, cardiac output, it also varies whenever abnormality is present in the heart or outside the heart, which can result in the pathological variation. Increase in the cardiac output that can be seen in various pathological conditions like fever, because of the increase in the metabolism, viscosity decreases, also because of the stimulation of the sympathetic system. During the fever, cardiac output increases. In the anemia as well as the hyperthyroidism, cardiac output increases. In the anemia, it produces hypoxia, as well as viscosity of the blood, it decreases, and it can result in increase in the cardiac output. In the hyperthyroidism, metabolism increases, and because of the increased metabolism, cardiac output increases. So in the fever, anemia, beriberi, hyperthyroidism, cardiac output increases, and these are all the pathological conditions. Decrease in the cardiac output occurs whenever heart is affected, which results in the rapid arrhythmias. And this rapid arrhythmias, it results in the abnormal conduction of the impulse as well as the ineffective contraction of the myocyte. And because of this incomplete filling, it results in the decrease in the cardiac output. In the congestive cardiac failure, because of the weak contraction of the heart, cardiac output gradually decreases. In the cardiac shock, as well as in the hemorrhage, because of the decrease in the blood volume, cardiac output decreases. In the cardiac shock, cardiac pumping it is affected, and because of the ineffective contraction of the heart, either because of the ischemia, infarction, or the heart block, it results in the poor pumping and the circulation, and it can decrease the cardiac output. In the hypothyroidism, because of the decrease in the basal metabolism, cardiac output decreases. So in the pathological variation, cardiac output either increases or decreases. So always remember, cardiac output, it increases during the fever, anemia, beriberi, and thyrotoxicosis, and cardiac output, it decreases whenever disease process affects the heart, like congestive cardiac failure, rapid arrhythmias, heart block, and cardiac shock, and various condition outside the heart, like the hemorrhage, which results in the decrease in the blood volume, as well as the hypothyroidism. All these conditions, they can decrease the cardiac output. So in this lecture, you have learned about some general definition related to the cardiac output. You have learned about various methods that are useful for the measurement of the cardiac output, as well as various condition in which variations are present in the cardiac output. So all these methods, they are useful for your viva purpose. They can be asked in your viva how cardiac output can be measured and their advantages as well as the disadvantages. So you have to remember the fixed method and the fixed principle that is useful for the measurement of the cardiac output. You have also learned about the variations in the cardiac output, physiological variation as well as the pathological variation. As a physician, you must be aware of various condition in which cardiac output also alters. So you must remember all these condition in which physiological as well as the pathological variations present and the reason behind it. And for your practical exam purpose, they are the frequently asked question that in which condition cardiac output alterations they are present. So in next lecture, I will explain more about the factors affecting the cardiac output. Thank you.